What's your answer to Jesus' question in verse 51? What's your answer to Jesus' question in verse 51? What do you want him to do for you? What do you want him to do for you? It's a real question. It's not hypothetical. It's a live issue, even if your answer is nothing. I don't want him to do anything for me. It's a live question, and you won't find a more condescending question anywhere. This is God in the flesh stooping to ask a blind beggar, what do you want me to do for you? And my prayer this morning is simply that Christ's mercy, the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, would be sought and known in your life. The real living mercy of the Lord Jesus would be sought and known in your life. We're simply going to do two things this morning. We're going to look at this glorious encounter in two ways. First of all, we're going to look at it in outline, just to be clear what takes place here. And then secondly, we're going to look at it in depth to get to the core of what's going on here. So in outline, to be clear, in depth, to get to the core. And before we do that, I want you to notice how at its heart, there are simply three things. First of all, a blind man sees. A blind man sees. It's a miracle of sight. Jesus here is demonstrating his power and his authority over illness. That's the first thing. A blind man sees. Secondly, this miracle is the second of two bookends here in Mark's Gospel, in this section. We've been looking for some weeks at this section, which is speaking about the nature of Jesus' messiahship, he's going to die and rise, and the nature of discipleship, it's going to be costly. And at the start of that section, we had a miracle of revelation. A man came to see, but he saw, if you remember, in two stages. To begin with, he saw men walking like trees. And then when Jesus touched him again, he saw. And that was to teach us what's going on in the life of Simon Peter, who's come to see who Jesus is, but he hasn't yet come to understand what kind of Messiah he's going to be. It's a two-stage thing in that first miracle. Here in this second miracle, Bartimaeus sees straight away. He understands what it is to be a disciple of Jesus, seeing who he is, and what he's really like. So a blind man sees, the second and closing bookend, a miracle of revelation again, somebody sees. And thirdly, there's a contrast here, isn't there, with the question that Jesus gave to James and John earlier on, verse 36. He asked them the same question, what do you want me to do for you? And they wanted glory for themselves. And when he asks the question to Bartimaeus, who could have asked for money, could have asked for power, could have asked for reputation, he said, I simply want to see. I simply want to see. I wonder if there's anyone here this morning who's got a hankering to, with the eye of faith, see. To see the truth, to see the beauty and wonder of Jesus Christ this morning. Let's look firstly at this encounter in outline. We're going to look at the setting, then the scene itself, then the setback, and then we're going to look at the centre of what goes on. So the setting, then the scene, then the setback, but then what's really at the centre of it all. The setting is found in verse 46. Now they came to Jericho, as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road, begging. That's the setting. Jesus, his disciples, and a great multitude come to and go out of Jericho. They don't appear to spend very long there. It's like walking into Shepshed under the motorway bridge, Hatherne Road. You come to the ballroom, but you don't stay. You go up Charnwood Road. You come in and you go out, and you go uphill. For Jesus and the disciples, the end of their road approaches, the end of their journey approaches. As we see in chapter 11, they reach Jerusalem, the last leg, the cross, where Jesus will die. It is an uphill stretch for them, 3,500 feet across 17 to 20 miles. That's going up the same height as Snowdon. It's quite a climb. They'd have been sweating in the heat. They'd probably been moaning the dust between their toes. And as they go out of Jericho, sitting at the roadside begging is a blind man. And his name is Bartimaeus. There must be something special about Bartimaeus because he's the only person healed in the synoptics, Matthew, Mark, Luke, who's named. Nobody else is named, but Bartimaeus is. Perhaps it's because he went on to be very well known. In Matthew's account, he tells us there were two blind men there. Mark and Luke just focus on the one. And up to this moment, it's presumably been a very ordinary day for Bartimaeus. He's woken up, he's put his outer garment on. He couldn't have seen his face in the mirror. He couldn't see the blueness of the sky. He could feel the heat of the sun, but he didn't know what colour it was. And presumably he stumbles, perhaps on an arm, perhaps led by somebody, perhaps by knowledge, as he feels his way along the road. He comes to the curbside where he sits, as was his custom, looking for mercy, looking for somebody to be kind to him, to give him something he didn't deserve, that he might be able to buy some food and to eat. Just like today for you, perhaps, it started off an ordinary day. But for Bartimaeus, it's all about to change. Because then, Bartimaeus hears something that changes his life for an eternity. He hears the noise of people coming down the street. Ooh, coppers, money, going to be a good day. And it's Luke, he says, that he asks what the fuss is about. Who is it, he says, and he's told that it's Jesus of Nazareth. Strictly speaking, it's Jesus the Nazarene. He's coming down Bartimaeus' street. And suddenly, in hearing that, hope and expectation dawn on him, like a hot sun emerging from behind a dark cloud on a cool day. That's the setting. Bartimaeus is where he normally is, but there's something very special about this day. Jesus the Nazarene is coming. That's the setting. Then there's the scene. And to begin with, you hear a new voice. It's the voice of Bartimaeus. He begins to cry out. Well, you would, wouldn't you? I mean, who wouldn't cry out in these circumstances? He cried out. Why? Well, doubtless because he'd heard of the compassionate, wonder-working teacher from Nazareth. Isn't it sad that millions in the world today still haven't heard his name? Bartimaeus presumed he had heard. And he believes that Jesus could do for him what he'd done for others, what nobody else could do, what he himself couldn't do, what he most wanted. Oh, wouldn't that be marvellous? Wouldn't that be marvellous if that happened to me? He's coming down my streets. And so he calls out. And he calls him by his messianic title. Son of David, Son of David, he says. He recognises Jesus as a king, a descendant of King David. And as he recognises who he is, he cries out and says, have mercy on me. Lord, have mercy on me, little blind, begging Bartimaeus. That's what he's focused on, mercy. Mercy is the compassionate treatment of those in distress, especially when it's in our power to punish or harm them. Bartimaeus wants mercy. Jesus once told the story of a man who owed his master, the king, a sum of money he couldn't pay. And so the man begged for mercy. And his master, the king, released him, forgiving him all his debt. It was an undeserved kindness, but he received this mercy. And Bartimaeus does something here which can teach you and me a real lesson. He recognizes his own need for mercy. He recognizes that he could be treated in a way that he doesn't deserve. He's not perfect. He's not loved God with all his heart, soul, strength, and mind. The reason God's put him here. So he needs mercy. And Jesus can supply what he needs. Jesus is merciful. It's a quality he's known for. So the scene is set up. There was the setting. Then he hears. Then he calls. And then there's a setback. Verse 48. Then many warned him to be quiet, but he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." I must confess, I thought about this last Saturday when a friend of mine, who's probably in his 40s now, lives in the city of Coventry, and his daughter, who perhaps is about 10, won a prize at school. And she won a prize to go and see Coventry City play football. I wonder what first prize would have been, but still. And he went to his first game. And I thought, I wonder what kind of questions she's going to ask. I could imagine it being a chatterbox all the way through. What's going on? What's going on? Because that reminded me of a little boy who, when he went to his first game, must have done the same. Because some very unpleasant lady in front of him turned round at one point and said to his uncle, "Can't you keep that child quiet? Shut up." That's what happened here. Bartimaeus shut up. But you couldn't silence Bartimaeus. He cried all the more. He wouldn't be silenced. This was his moment. It might pass. He had to pursue it with all that he had. He was desperate. It's all set up. There's the scene. He cries. And then there's a setback which is overcome because Bartimaeus had got one of those hearts which wouldn't let go until he had received. And then the centre of the encounter itself. Bartimaeus hadn't stopped, but Jesus did. He suddenly stops and he stands still. He's got time for the cry of a blind beggar. And he commands that Bartimaeus be called to him, and the fickle crowd, who've told him to shut up, now change their tune from shut up to, "Oh, be of good cheer, rise, he's calling you." And it's interesting that Luke says that at the end of all of this, they give praise to God. Beware of crowds, they are often fickle and untrustworthy. Jesus stops and calls him, and Bartimaeus does three things. He throws aside his garment, he rises to his feet, and the Bible simply says, verse 50, he came to Jesus. What a text that is. He came to Jesus. Movement towards, a heart moved towards him. Perhaps you've sung that song, "I came to Jesus as I was, weary and worn and sad. I found in him a resting place, he has made me glad." Bartimaeus throws off his garment, stands on his feet, and comes to Jesus. And Jesus asks the question in verse 51, "What do you want me to do for you?" And with the whole of his future destiny at stake, Bartimaeus says, "Rabboni," which could be, "Oh, great one, master, that I may receive my sight." I'd love to be able to see. I'm not looking for wealth and coppers in my jar today. I'm not looking for power or reputation or glory like James and John were. I simply want to see. And Jesus says two things. He says, "Go your way. Your faith has made you well." Could be translated, "Your faith has saved you." Go your way. And immediately Bartimaeus receives his sight, follows Jesus on the road. That's the encounter in outline, the setting, the scene, the setback, the centre. But now let's look at the encounter in depth. Secondly and finally, that this encounter might go beyond our minds. needs to go into our minds, but it needs to go beyond our minds, affecting our hearts and our wills. Firstly, it's an encounter of faith. Faith. Jesus' words in verse 52, this is what he highlights. Your faith has made you well. Words that Jesus said to others, to the woman with the issue of blood, daughter, your faith has made you well. The occasion Jesus healed 10 lepers and only one came back, and he was a Samaritan, to thank the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, arise, go your way, your faith has made you well. Jesus works here through the faith of Bartimaeus, faith in the healings. But listen, throughout the scripture, faith is the means or the channel by which someone receives salvation from God. The channel by which they receive the forgiveness of their sins. We're going to hear from Ephesians chapter 2 next Saturday afternoon. And in that chapter we read, by grace, Paul says to the believers at Ephesus, by grace you have been saved through faith. Through faith. It's of God's kindness, but through your faith. So we must have this faith. The Bible says faith is the assurance of things hoped for. We're certain about the things that are guaranteed from God in his word. It's the conviction of things not seen. Very simply, it's to completely rely upon someone or something. That's faith. You go on a journey and you rely on your sat-nav. Sometimes it's reliable, sometimes it isn't. But you put your faith in it. You phone somebody up and say, well, we can't come over next weekend. I've looked at my app and it's going to pour all weekend. You put your faith in your weather app. Organise your life around it. And if you want to make a frosted walnut cake, then you probably put your faith in Mary Berry's baking Bible. That's what I want to make. Don't know how to do it. I'll follow her line by line. You're putting your faith in those words. Faith is to believe and act upon something that you believe to be true. To believe and act upon something that you believe to be true. Now, in Bartimaeus' case, he believed that Jesus would give him eyesight. And he based that belief presumably on what Jesus had done for others, or maybe because he recognized, as we know he did, that Jesus was the Messiah, and he knew that when Messiah came, according to the Old Testament prophets, the eyes of the blind shall be opened. Isaiah 35, verse 5. So he's basing his faith on something. He's believing what God has said. And I want to ask you, as I asked myself this morning, what about our faith, your faith? You see, this is showing us what becoming a disciple of Jesus looks like. And we must have faith in Christ if we're going to be saved from our sins. If we're going to be forgiven, we must exercise faith. If you're going to be reconciled to God, you must exercise faith. You must believe and act upon what is true. The Bible says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. God, in his great wisdom, has chosen the exercise of faith to be the thing which glorifies him. That we believe what he has said. You see, it isn't enough merely to know in our minds. Like Bartimaeus, there has to be movement towards a coming to Christ. And that's through faith. And open your hand, open to receive believingly what God gives. You bring the open hand to him, expecting him to do what he says he will do. Call upon his name and he'll save you. No one is saved from their sin and from hell without faith. It's a lesson of faith. Secondly, notice more briefly, three initial aspects. What's this faith look like, this becoming a disciple? First of all, faith recognizes who Jesus is. Bartimaeus says, you're the son of David. You are the king. You are God's king. So you have power and authority over all things even sickness, even blindness, you are able, you are the King. Who do you recognize Jesus to be this morning? Jesus of Nazareth, who is God's King, who, having established an eternal throne from which he rules his kingdom, will one day bring that kingdom to fullness and finality in a new creation. And through trusting in him, you can be part of that, the world as we want it to be, and better, the new creation. Do you recognize Jesus to be that great King this morning? God's Savior King, who alone can save me and you from our sins, from hell, from death, from Satan. Have you ever acknowledged who Jesus Christ really is and told him? In effect, bowed your heart before him and said, Lord Jesus, I can't see you. And I've not acknowledged you as I should have done, but I now see who you really are. And I'm so sorry for my sin and that I haven't acknowledged you, but you really are Lord, are you? Aren't you? You really are King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and recognized him. Secondly, faith acknowledges its need of and Christ's supply of mercy. So one thing he asks for, Son of David, have mercy on me. It's what many others in the scripture asked for, the tax collector in Jesus' parable. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. He's often said that's the beginning of everybody's Christian life. God, have mercy on me, a sinner. You see, mercy is my need and your need this morning, the compassionate treatment of those in misery and distress, especially when it's within somebody's power to punish us. And it's within God's power to punish us for our sins. He has every right to justly punish us forever for the way that we have rebelled, defied, denied him, despised him, disdained him, dishonored him, desecrated his creation, really, in a way in which we've lived. There's nothing we need more this morning than his undeserved kindness to us. We've shaken our fists at him. A mother once approached Napoleon, seeking a pardon for her son. And the emperor replied that the young man had committed a certain offense twice, and therefore justice demanded his death. And the mother said, I don't ask for justice, I plead for mercy. And Napoleon said, but your son doesn't deserve mercy. And she said, well, it wouldn't be mercy if he deserved it. It's mercy that I'm asking for, undeserved kindness. Well then, the emperor said, I will have mercy. And he spared the woman's son. You know, you and I really can be spared what we deserve, because we've got a God who is merciful, rich in mercy, delights to show mercy. And Jesus alone can supply you with the mercy that you need, because you, cut off from God, facing condemnation, he alone can restore you to your true purpose in life. Because he came in love from heaven to take the punishment of your sins, that punishment would not fall upon you, but rather he would be treated as though he had lived your life and you could be treated as though you'd lived his perfect life. Do you ever come face to face and acknowledge your need of mercy, and that what you need is found alone in the Lord Jesus Christ? Why would you resist him? Faith recognizes who Jesus is, it acknowledges its need and supply of mercy, and it calls out to him and persists. He began to cry. He said, Lord, have mercy on me. When he was told to shut up, he cried all the more. Lord, have mercy on me. Please don't depart from this life without voicing this cry from your heart. Don't depart from this life without voicing this cry from your heart. Don't live a moment longer without issuing this urgent, sincere plea. You need God's mercy. You've sinned against him like I have. But that mercy is found in Christ alone. So plead for it personally. So many encouragements are given to you to do that. Ask, seek, knock. Lord, have mercy on me. You too proud to ask that this morning? Too proud to say, Lord, have mercy on me. Faith recognizes who Jesus is, acknowledges the need of and Christ's supply of mercy, and calls and persists until it's found. And then finally, these things result. Number one, a dramatic change, which could not be a greater contrast. The blind man receives his sight. Just think about it. You couldn't have a greater contrast, could you? I can't see anything. Wow. That's the face of Jesus of Nazareth. And there's the trees. And there's the sky. Oh, the sun's that colour. How incredible. What a contrast. What a powerful contrast. What a magnificently good contrast. It couldn't have been a greater contrast. Suddenly, in an instant, Bartimaeus' life and horizons are transformed unimaginably as he literally enters into a different world of light and life. And the Bible says that when we come to faith, that's having our spiritual eyes opened by God to God. That's part of the picture here, that we're blind by nature spiritually, but we need a miracle of God to open our eyes, that we'd see what's there. That's why we're going to sing in a few minutes, I once was blind, but now I see, because of his amazing grace. It's not simply that we believe different things to other people, though that's obviously part of it, but more than that, we've entered into a different world. We've entered into a world of infinite horizons. We really have been forgiven all of our sins. We have come to possess eternal life. We now know the triune God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, personally, intimately. He's raised us from spiritual death to spiritual life. And now we enjoy him and live in fellowship with him. You can't get a greater contrast in life. It changes everything. Heaven above is softer blue. Earth around is sweeter green. Something lives in every hue, that's colour or shade, that Christless eyes have never seen. You see, when your eyes are open to who Christ is, that the colours are different. You see part of the beauty of the Creator and the majesty and the wonder. You are living in a different realm. Birds with gladder songs overflow. Flowers with deeper beauties shine. Since I know as now I know, I am his and he is mine. There's no greater contrast in life. There's no more powerful contrast, no more magnificently good contrast than to have tasted and seen that the Lord is good. A dramatic change inwardly in the heart. Secondly, we then follow Jesus on the road. Bartimaeus was sat by the roadside, and then he came to follow Jesus on the road, an uphill road leading to the cross and the empty tomb. And though you've heard this morning, to what extent is it true of you that you're still sat by the roadside as a spectator? You've heard, you've watched, you're part of the fickle crowd. Have you followed? Can I encourage you this morning to throw aside whatever hinders you today, to rise and in faith to follow Jesus Christ with all your heart? To turn, to repent of your sin and your unbelief and to follow Jesus on the road, which at sometimes is very steep, but leads not now to destruction, but to glory. It's a dramatic change. It causes us to follow Jesus along the road that leads to the cross. And lastly, that road leads into the life to come. And I end here this morning because miracles have many purposes. They are to show that Jesus' claims are true. They are pictures of the gospel and hear what it is to have our eyes, spiritual eyes, opened. But one of the purposes of miracles is to show what the world to come will be like for believers. No physical blindness, no deafness, no sin, no pain, no death, no crying. Consider what that means for you if you're a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ here this morning, and your destiny and your hope. You're only really here for about the length of a grain of sand, and then there's eternity. And for those who believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is God's King, to those who put their trust in him, to those who recognize who he truly is, acknowledge their need of his mercy and that he supplies it, to those who called upon him personally, will you undergo the greatest change known on earth, from death to life, from spiritual blindness to spiritual sight. It's utterly glorious. Follow him along the road as his disciple until you come to spend forever with the Lord. His mercies are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. We all need to seek his mercies from the moment that we rise in the morning. You've heard. Won't you throw aside your garment? Won't you rise? And won't you come in repentance and faith to the Lord Jesus Christ, that his mercy, having been sought by you, would be known.